edge connectivity is a bigger issue today than ever before. And nowhere is it more important than in the realm of Industry 4.0. But not all connectivity solutions are best suited for an industrial setting. Our old communication methods aren't going to cut it. Like Goldilocks when she was searching for the best place to take a nap, we need a solution that is just right. No, not this one. The latency isn't good enough. No, not this one. The reach isn't long enough. And definitely not this one. There seems to be a bear sleeping in it. Wait, I think I'm mixing up stories here. It is no fable that in order to keep up with the breakneck speed of today's innovation in Industry 4.0, we need an efficient way to connect a wide variety of edge nodes to the cloud without breaks in our communication networks, and with shorter latency, lower power, and longer reach. What we need is seamless Ethernet. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. Industry 4.0 has presented us with a variety of communication challenges. And in order to make sure our systems communicate properly, we need seamless communication between our edge nodes, the cloud, and back again. In this episode of Chalk Talk, Fiona Tracy from Analog Devices joins me to discuss the benefits of seamless Ethernet. We take a closer look at how, with its twisted single-pair design, long reach, and power and data over one cable, can solve your industry connectivity woes. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about seamless Ethernet solutions from Analog Devices. Hi, Fiona. Thank you so much for joining me.
Great to be here. And look forward to talking to you about this topic today.
Okay, so we're talking about seamless Ethernet to the edge today. But Fiona, before we get started, this all has to do with the future of connectivity in Industry 4.0, right?
Yes, and of course, we've all heard the buzz, you know, about Industry 4.0 and the promise to change the way we create products thanks to the digitization of our manufacturing and our process facilities. But really, Industry 4.0, it's all about fueling our automation systems with increased data, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and expanding our capabilities for productivity. And to do this, we need to capture new data and new insights into all of our manufacturing equipment across our process and manufacturing environments. And the other important area is our building automation systems. And today, actually, over 40% of energy consumption is actually within some of our commercial buildings. So the ability to reduce our global energy consumption can also be tied back to an ability to invest in retrofitting centered around driving increased utilization of the building itself and the assets within that building. So when you take both our process automation and our Industry 4.0, our intelligent buildings and green buildings and market drivers, the reality is we've all these devices spread around at the edge that we can't access today, right? We've very limited connectivity. We've no real ability to configure them in anything like real time. And there's no auxiliary information coming from these edge nodes. So what we're talking about is making all of these edge devices connected and interconnected. And how we do that is through our connectivity network becomes the backbone of our process facility, of our building and of our factory. And this technology we're talking about today is all about enabling that seamless connectivity from the edge to the cloud to enable all of these optimizations with Industry 4.0.
That makes sense. Now, Fiona, what kind of benefits does seamless edge bring to these kind of systems?
Yes, so the whole thing where TEM-based T1L technology really comes into play is about the seamlessness of the connectivity. And when we talk about bringing Ethernet to the edge and having this communication network all based seamlessly on one communication of Ethernet. And this is all about replacing, you know, legacy communications. And these have created these pockets of information and isolation of data within our networks. And this is information we can't access today, so we can't utilize it, we can't learn from it. And because they've been based on proprietary legacy network systems, this is what's really limited the flow of information. And it's required the need for gateways and translation layers between the various connectivity networks that we use today in our factories or in our buildings. And the idea is, if you've seamless Ethernet connectivity, your measurement data can start out life at the edge node as an Ethernet packet, and then it traverses, as we see on our slide, seamlessly from the edge to the cloud. So you don't need to translate as you move up to our control networks. So Ethernet will enable direct access to all of this new measurement data, but not just that, like it'll also enable access to device parameters, lifecycle management data, predictive maintenance, and we mentioned that configurability and the parameterization of these edge devices. And I suppose you're probably going to ask, why haven't we enabled Ethernet connectivity today to these edge nodes? And I guess the answer kind of lies in the fact that up until now, we didn't really have an Ethernet standard for long reach Ethernet connectivity. We had 100 meters today, or maybe even 200 meters. But there is some broad reach standards, but they really have very poor latency and very poor power consumption. So they're very power hungry. And this makes them really unsuitable to address what we set out with at the start, to have this low power, efficient Ethernet technology.
That makes sense. Now, can you explain a bit more what exactly is the 10 base T1L?
Yes. And I suppose 10 base T1L is a physical layer standard. And this group, as you see on the slide, the IEEE 802.3CG standard, it's covered under that standard. And it enables both power and data to be provided to the sensor or an actuator over this 1 kilometer of single twisted pair cable. So it's a single pair media standard. And when we look at the features, there's 4 key features. So one, we're talking about power and data over the cable. So if you talk about our edge nodes, they require power, or the ability to deliver power is critical when particularly they're in remote and maybe hard to access locations. So by providing power over the single twisted pair, it means you do not need to deliver power on a separate data line to each individual sensor. So you were transmitting the data and the power together on one pair. The other thing we have is that 10 base T1L technology would enable increased levels of power to actually be delivered on the cable versus legacy technologies. So now we have more power at the edge, so we could do more processing there. Before we transmit the data, we could have better capabilities at the edge, you know, enhanced GUIs and interfaces. The second one is bandwidth. And now we're talking about 10 megabits per second. And this increase in bandwidth over existing technologies like 4 to 20 milliamp, RS-485 and CAN, it provides the ability to transfer these much greater and richer data sets that we're now capturing at the edge. So we now have the ability to transform more information. And higher bandwidth fundamentally means more information can be transmitted faster. The third thing I've mentioned, single twisted pair cabling. So these cables have the advantage over standard Cat X cables of being lower cost, smaller and lighter. And they are often easier then to install, simplifying the overall commissioning. And because they're smaller, you know, we're talking about smaller connectors as well for single pair Ethernet. And that can be important when we're thinking about edge nodes where they might be on the wall in a building, for example. Having those aesthetically small is important. And finally, and what's of course most importantly when we're talking about edge connectivity, is this reach and the ability to transfer Ethernet over 1 kilometer of cable. And that's really what is transformative.
Okay, so I think I understand the basics here, but Fiona, what does this all really buy me as an engineer?
Yes, so there's a couple of really key benefits. And the first one is IP addressability. So it has this ability to provide each edge node with a unique IP address. So we can communicate directly with and identify each of our edge nodes. We can commission them, we can decommission them, we can configure them independently of all the other nodes on the network. And with Ethernet connectivity, it's possible to configure a sensor or a node, whether that node is sitting on my desk at work or whether it's deployed a kilometer away in a process facility. I can configure it with my laptop or my mobile phone, wherever I might be, once I can connect to it over the cloud. So it effectively means real-time configurability or reconfigurability. And therefore, you're removing this need to have service personnel being deployed or going out yourself to commission or recommission instruments. And the other big thing it means in terms of the overall lower cost of ownership at a network level, so in either our building or our process facility, because we're removing all of these translation layers that we talked about and these gateways, and we're simplifying the network to be solely based on Ethernet. It's eliminating the fragmented nature of the network built around lots of different types of communication technology. So it's reducing that support burden. And we're talking about and having a network-centric infrastructure where there's lots of savings to be availed of in terms of cost of the plant operation, maintenance, and installation. So they're the big two.
That makes sense. Now, Fiona, what kind of specific applications do you see this kind of connectivity helping enable?
Yes, so there's a couple of great application examples, and I'm going to start by looking at the one in commercial building management. So if you take TEM-based T1L technology being used to connect, for example, our HVAC systems, so heating, ventilation, air conditioning control. You've also, you know, in our buildings, you've things like our elevators, our fire safety systems, our digital signage, our IP cameras, operator control panels. How about having all of those seamlessly connected throughout our building management systems with TEM-based T1L Ethernet connectivity? And HVAC systems actually are one of the big contributors to energy consumption within a building. So by deploying a network of directly addressable sensors, controlling fans, etc., connecting back to a centralized cloud-enabled maybe analytics and management system, you know, we could transform the building management decisions that we would make. So we can see from our graphic how seamless Ethernet from the cloud to the edge can be deployed with TEM-based T1L technology. And there's multiple use cases, from the room controller being connected to other room controllers or to a building controller, which all of them could be up to a kilometer apart, or a daisy chain ring of sensors that would be deployed in a room. Another good example is fire safety, where TEM-based T1L technology would be deployed because they need higher data bandwidth to provide high fidelity signals, time synchronization of the commands, and our visual beacons and alarms in the buildings in the event of maybe an incident there, and to trigger an evacuation. And in the diagram, I suppose, is designed here just to show this utopic vision of barrier-free networking across all devices and components in our building to enable this fast, secure implementation of IoT in buildings. So take, for example, occupancy, where you want to restrict the access of an area or monitor the access to an area, particularly in this COVID-19 world that we're now living in. You know, having the ability to program or reconfigure in real time an edge node and to restrict or constrict the access to a particular area depending on how many people are in that area or how many people have been in contact with others within that area. So that could be transformative. And we've also mentioned fire safety. So fire safety is another application where TEM-based T1L technology will be deployed because we need that high data bandwidth to provide very high fidelity, time synchronized audio commands or these visual beacons in the event of an incident where, you know, a building might need to be evacuated.
Wow, that really makes sense. So Fiona, tell us a little bit more about the kind of solutions you guys have in this space.
Yes, so I guess ADI has a unique portfolio because we offer both a TEM-based T1L PHY, so physical layer device, and a TEM-based T1L MAC-PHY. What's unique about the MAC-PHY is that the Ethernet connectivity to the processor, you know, as you can see in the diagram there, is via what we call SPI. And that reduces the burden on the processor and removes the need for an integrated MAC. And this means you can now utilize a low power processor, which does not have an integrated Ethernet MAC. So we're talking about a processor that does not support MII or MII or RGMII media independent interfaces. And this is a lot of the processors that you see today being used at the edge because they're very low power. So a traditional PHY cannot connect to such low power processors, but our MAC PHY can. And this is particularly important where you want to reuse as much of your existing sensor node design, like in a field instrument design, but update just the communication portion to Ethernet. So by leveraging a MAC PHY, you can reuse a lot of your existing processor choices, your existing software infrastructure, but add Ethernet capability. So you're reducing your development costs and your development burden and getting to market faster. So there's always going to be a balancing act between, you know, leveraging existing investments and design architectures and then optimizing for new technologies, for power, for space. So ADI's portfolio of 10-based T1L solutions is designed to provide you with that flexibility by offering the choice between PHY and MAC-PHY. And, you know, for new designs where you have more flexibility on processor choice, higher power options are available to you that support traditional Ethernet interfaces, then you could use our ADIN110 PHY technology. And of course, both solutions are fully compliant to the standard we mentioned, that IEEE 802.3 CG. And they're available now from ADI and our partner Mouser. And they're designed for ultra-low power consumption, robustness. They're extensively tested to ensure performance in that harshest industrial environments where we've just kind of talked about that they're going to be deployed.
So, Fiona, are there any other benefits to this type of system?
Yes, and I guess another benefit to our MAC-PHY technology, particularly if you look at it in the case of a field instrument, is this advanced packet filtering features. So what does advanced packet filtering mean? It's about reducing the burden of handling what we call broadcast and multicast traffic. And this means it helps to really offload that burden from the processor. So you're filtering by the destination MAC address is what's key here. And instead of just a single MAC address, the MAC-PHY can support filtering on up to 16 unicast or multicast addresses. Also, we provide things like frame statistics, and they are something gathered by the MAC to assist in monitoring the network traffic and the overall quality of the link. And the MAC and the MAC-PHY supports the IEEE 1588 and therefore 802.1 AS time synchronization as required in process automation. So it provides support for synchronized counters, timestamping of receive messages, timestamp capture of transmit messages, and all of this is designed to reduce the complexity of the software design as there is no further hardware support needed to implement this time synchronization functions beyond our MAC-PHY hardware.
That makes sense. Now, Fiona, you mentioned process control. Can we talk about that a little more?
Yes. So in process control, we have what's termed here on our diagram a trunk and spur topology. So we have spurs, which go out to our edge nodes that we've been talking about, and they are typically our field instruments. And they're often deployed in intrinsically safe environments. These are shown at the bottom of our graph here in the purple. These field devices, you know, they connect back to a field switch, which is the blue layer in our diagram, and then onto power switch, which is your green layer. The trunk links, which can be up to a kilometer in length, in process requires ultra-low power consumption devices and high performance to be deployed on the same Ethernet network and comply with the strict maximum power limitations for hazardous area use cases. So if you look at the requirements for the field or the power switch layers, here we're talking about 10-based T1L, relatively high power processing requirements in this use case, and therefore, generally, they'll be utilizing a higher-end processor that supports those interfaces we talked about previously, like MII, RMII, or GMII, and so our ADIN110 PHY becomes the ideal choice for this use case, offering robust, low-power 10-based T1L PHY technology. And then at the other end, when we look at the field instrument side, we're probably looking at our MacFi because it provides that increased flexibility in terms of the choice we talked about for that lower power processor. And by optimizing the application partitioning the way ADI has with 10Base T1L MacFi, it enables overall lower power system designs, which are particularly important for this zone zero intrinsically safe application use case. And of course, there'll also be higher power field instruments like flow meters, for example. And here you may use our actual PHY because you have more power available and a higher power processor. So this use case of process control is a really good example to show how the flexibility provided by ADI and that choice supports you in, you know, optimizing your design for power and for reusability of some of your existing technology.
Great. Well, Fiona, this has been a lot to take in today. Can you recap your main points for me?
Yes. So I guess the key point is that ADI has now available two key products, our PHY, which is our ADIN1100, and our MacPHY, which is our ADIN1100. And while the MacPHY offers a power consumption of 43 milliwatts and our PHY 39 milliwatts, you're talking about for 4 extra milliwatts with the MacPHY, you can have a much lower power system design by leveraging a much lower power processor. So you're maximizing your system partitioning to minimize your system power. Both of these products, they are fully attested and proven for auto-negotiation mode of operation over 1.7 kilometers of reach. As I mentioned, they're fully compliant with the IEEE standard. The other thing we should mention, you know, the standard is very much specified around a reach of 1 kilometer, which we kind of introduced at the start of today's session. These application use cases we've discussed, you cannot guarantee what your link partner is. So you must design for the standard, which is the 1 kilometer. But ADI is just tested beyond that to give you confidence and peace of mind in terms of the ability of our solution. And of course, we're extensively testing over hosts of different types of cables as well, and the noisy environment, that noisy industrial environment where we know these products will be deployed. And of course, reach, as you know, will be very much dependent on the type of cables you use. And for this standard, we don't actually specify a specific cable or define a specific cable, but rather a link segment with specific parameters. That's what's covered under the standard.
Okay, so Fiona, if I'm ready to get started, what are my next steps?
Yes, so ADI has a whole host of development boards, samples, media converters available now to get you started. So if you want to develop a field instrument, field switch, building controller, sensor node, then we have what's needed at analog.com or mauser.com. I should also point out that both of these solutions, they've been extensively tested for EMI, EMC robustness, so they're ideally suited for operation in the harsh environments. And of course, you can consult our data sheet, which is available online for the latest news and information on the specifications. And we also offer a whole host of diagnostic features that we didn't have time to go into today to test things like the link quality with some of our MSC techniques. And we also offer the ability to do TDR, which is time domain reflectometry, which can be used to detect opens and shorts in a cable or a link, and the distance to that fault or the location of that fault. So there are other things to look out for and to check out on analog.com or mauser.com.
Fantastic. Well, Fiona, I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from Analog Devices. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, check out the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or head on over to YouTube, youtube.com/EEJournal.